Let me look hard. Okay. Okay, so let's direct go for today's topic. So we'll talk about some of gene expression analysis, gene expression data analysis. I'm not sure how many of the students you are at the you're working with. So I'm not sure how many of the students are working in a kind of a medical school's lab, or kind of are dealing with some medical topic. But I think one of the biased topic for this virtual research is virtual-based research is to analyze some biomedical data. If you are involving in a kind of a medical, kind of a lab in the School of Medicine. So today I'm going to introduce a data. This data is named as a gene expression data. So there are two major technologies. One is RNA microarray, the other is RNA-seq. So I think you may have already know that the kind of in your biology course, you may know the gene may transcribe into RNA, mRNA, and mRNA can be translated into proteins, right? So I can tell you, so even there are some methods to measure, recently there are some methods to measure the gene kind of a protein level from kind of a, it's called high throughput measuring that measures a whole bunch of proteins, different types of proteins from a given sample. Even there are some of this method, but this type of method is still very expensive and cannot be fully utilized by everyone. So it's not super commercialized. So, but instead there is another way is to measure the mRNA samples. So for the student who is confused, a little bit confused about the protein mRNA and gene protein mRNA. So I think just go check about the transcription and translation. You will know how this process gets done. So okay, it's like this one. So gene may transcribe the coding gene, DNA codes gene, and then the gene may transcribe into mRNA, and the mRNA may translate into protein, and the protein may take function. But the problem is that based on the current technology, so the measuring of protein is very relatively expensive and not so feasible to every lab. So, but there is a commercialized way to measure mRNA. But the mRNA is you can consider the DNA for all of the cells have the same DNA. But for different cells, they may select to express certain mRNA and translate into certain protein to enable the cell type specific, tissue type specific, organ specific, and also condition specific functions. For example, if a cell is going to proliferate, it may just start to kind of translate or produce the protein involved in the cell proliferation. So to start this approach, the cells will have a kind of an increased kind of a mRNA of proliferation related mRNA expressed, right? So then by measuring the mRNA just transcribed at different sample, the data can tell, okay, definitely can explain what's the kind of or be utilized to characterize some current biological characteristics of the sample. Just for example, if we measure the data or a sample under proliferating, kind of under fast cell proliferation, so and the sample under kind of relatively slow cell proliferation, the gene expression of the genes related in cell proliferation will be kind of more expressed in the sample with fast proliferation, right? So there are basically two ways to measure those data, because the challenge is what? The challenge is in our human body, we encode 20,000 genes. We have 20,000 genes. And that means if we want to measure a full kind of characterization of the gene expression, what we may need to do is to measure all of those genes, those mRNAs simultaneously from one sample. So this kind of call for definitely some experimental idea for the kind of like the high throughput mirroring. So definitely there are multiple clever ideas have been utilized to enable such a high throughput mirroring. So when we, so microarray was invented, I think almost 20 years. So the idea is straightforward. We make a chip. On the chip, each dot, there is a kind of a, can recognize certain mRNA. Because for the mRNA of different genes, they have a specific sequence. So they are very kind of different and may have a special sequence. And the sequence can, but for the different sequence, they may have different binding affinity to the sequence, to their reverse side. For example, ATCG, the reverse part is TAGC, right? If we put certain of their reverse sequence on the chip, and they can bind there with high binding affinity. And if we attach a fluorescent marker to the mRNA, sample, and let the mRNA be bound to the kind of to the chip. So then what we can measure is kind of for each of the specifically designed, we call it a probe. For this probe, it can measure kind of the level of the strength of the binding of kind of the current, the mRNA bound to this or combined to this specific probe region, and by measure the fluorescent marker, the level of the fluorescent marker. And this level directly tell you kind of the relative concentration of the mRNA can be specifically bind to this probe. So basically it's just to utilize the, with a given sample, we put some fluorescent marker on the mRNA, definitely with some other process, and then watch the RNA on the, watch the fluorescent marker banded sample to the kind of to the chip, and then measure the fluorescence level of each of the chip, and we can collect the expression level of each mRNA. And the other technique is more recently developed, but it's already more than 10 years. So it's called RNA sequencing, RNA-seq. So basically so for each of the mRNA sample, we can chop it into small pieces. And there is a recent technique can simultaneously measure short reads, the small short reads simultaneously for a very large amount of short reads. After you get those measured, we map them back to the genes, to the genome. You can see here, sample one, sample two, and we can count the number of small pieces mapped back to each gene and do the comparison whether they show a difference or not among the samples. So this is a basic technique. And how the data looks like, I think you have learned this, some visualization. This is a heat map I introduced before. And so this data, so this is just each row is in the gene expression data, each row is one sample. Each row is one gene. Normally we use each row is one gene, as one gene, each column as one sample. So the I may show you, so just to start from the real world example. Start from this real world example. So here is the data. So we just utilize R and to illustrate. So today I may not kind of, I will provide the link later, but today I may just utilize the R just to illustrate to you kind of that you are not so far from the research, kind of with the kind of current code commands you have learned, you can already do some research actually. So this is only one variable in this data. So we see how it looks like. It's called TCG data. These are not date. These are also actually genes. So we just do edit for 1 to 50 and 1 to 5. So you can see here each one is a gene name, And each column is a sample name. We just show the first five columns, and we can show the dimension, also show the dimension of it. This is the dimension. So you see there are 55,000 genes. But those genes are about more than, other than genes, there are also non-long coding RNA and also other kind of important molecular biology features in the data. So it's kind of, we measure other than genes, we also measure something else. So in total, there are 55,000 features in the collecting in this data. It just looks like a plain, it's just a plain matrix, and each row is one gene, each sample is, each column is one sample. Okay, so this is just a, these are just two figures I directly copy paste from some two published papers. First one is just a heat map. We have shown this in my last kind of in my last lecture before these two lectures. So it just red means here in this figure, you can see here is how to read this heat map. Red means a higher value, blue means lower value here, right? So you can see red means, oh, those are highly red regions. Those are highly blue regions, right? And so that means for those genes, they have the kind of in those postnatal samples. So they are red, they are very low, but since it's fetal samples, they're relatively high, right? And also this is also you can, this is a fluorescence marker. So it's, this is for microarray data. You can see there are distinct difference between male and female. And there are even more distinct features, right? And this is how the kind of just based on some visualization, you can already show the trend of the data. But the critical thing is we have the, sorry. So the critical thing is we have this number of features, 55,000 features. And the majority of the features I can tell is kind of not so important. So, or not so disease relevant, but only when you measure two, for example, you measure two condition difference. I can give you one example is recently, oh yeah, recently we received the data. That this data is what? It's about the mouse tissue as a mouse. That this mouse is utilized to simulate the condition of a specific disease. And this disease is called neurofibromatosis. And this disease is a pediatric disease, and but this disease may only kind of involve in certain genetic deficiency, and it's not a highly systematic disease. But definitely, it's a systematic, but it's not as systematic as a solid tumor. So when we measure, and then what we did is our collaborator identified a drug target. And this drug target is called, I think it's called MDM2, I think. This is a TP53 inhibitor, I think. So they use the MDM2 inhibition on it and then test the difference. So I can show you some of the, maybe we can show some results here. So so this is how I can, maybe I can show you, this is how we work through the process. So basically in the beginning, so we have the, so this is from the sequencing core. So who conducted the experiment and generated this data. And to access the data, we have a certain link. And then this is from my collaborator. And then from the, and then I've sent this to my, let me see, this is how the experiment is conducted. You can see here is MDM2 inhibitor, vehicle means control, and MDM2 inhibitor means just inhibition of the MDM2 gene. And the mice was then sacrificed and the tumor harvested and do the RNA sequencing. This is how the kind of my collaborator describes the process. And how the data looks like is after we send this to the, so definitely the data is more complicated than what we can see here. But when we send, when, but but the processing process, we kind of, there are definitely some processing process we need to be run on the supercomputer of IU School of Medicine, and actually at Indiana University. And then after we did this analysis, did this data processing, my student returned the kind of her analysis log. So this is how the data was analysis. So this is a mouse data, MDM2 as the case, and vehicle as the control. So this is a simple data with only 8 samples. This is how the data was the analyzer, the processor data. We can download it and see how it looks like. So it's not a very, very big data, but we can show it in the... This is how the, sorry, I open it with Excel. So this is how the data looks like. So after her conducted the data mapping, so we get to the gene ID. Those are the gene ID. Those are the chromosome of the gene, start and strand. Those are just some gene information. So chromosome means just chromosome ID. This is not super important. And here's the gene length. Some genes are very long, but you can see this gene is, even this gene is very long, but these 8 values are the kind of results of this specific data. You can consider this are just general statistics. For each of the data, mouse data will have almost the same, just the same kind of a setting here in this 7 columns or six columns. And here from the 7th to the further, so these are just about the samples. Here we have 8 samples. You can see here 8 columns. And as provided by Steven, so here we can see the 2, 3 to 2, 11, 11. They are just the vehicle control and the 204 and the 205, 206, 212. Those are controls, right? So we can definitely see the controls and the inhibitor treated once. And these are just the general risk. We'll go back to this data later, and we can definitely use this data to do some showcase some of the analysis. Okay, so then we'll have but definitely this is some results, some R file, and given from my student, and we'll talk about this later. Yeah. Here are just the data, how the general kind of things we can deal with the data. And the gene expression data, so like I mentioned, each row is one gene, each column is sample. So what basic questions we can ask if we have this data? So as you have seen that, so we have for this specific condition that's given by this data given by Steven and analyzed by Kamen. So we definitely answer some questions. But here, this specific data is with two conditions. One is vehicle control, one is drug treatment. So what we want to see is what specific gene features show difference after the drug treatment, kind of how the drug affects the system. Definitely the drug may have some, in most cases for this type of experiment was when people conduct this analysis, this experiment is for what? Is we treat the kind of the experimentalist treat the system with a certain drug, and they found the kind of with really good outcome. For example, the tumor. Cancer study, I do more on cancer research. For cancer research, if we treat the kind of a cancer on a mouse with a certain drug, the tumor size shrink a lot. So that means this drug really have some function, some good function, good impact to the tumor, kind of to in treating the tumor, right? So but sometimes we don't know what mechanisms kind of make the kind of drug be functional. And actually more importantly, sometimes when we apply the drug, kind of when we just you applying drug to mouse and applying drug to human are actually relevant to different stories. So even when we found the drug can work on mouse, and it's good, it's a great signal, but still there is a long way to go to ensure this drug can really safely can apply it to human and can have certain, have definitely have good functions. So especially when we normally when we apply a drug to a cancer to a group of population of cancer patients, there are always patients with drug resistance mechanisms. So so definitely the question is what caused the resistance? Why these patients do not respond to this kind of to a certain drug? So for those questions, we don't know the kind of biological mechanisms. So when we want to really kind of mine what possibly happened there, so a straightforward way is, okay, if we can collect their sample, we measure their mRNA gene expression data, and then we identify if certain things are different between a certain population versus the other. For example, cancer versus normal, drug-treated versus non-treated, and resistant versus responder. So we can identify the specific difference or specific patterns that kind of related to one condition and of our interest, right? So this is called differential analysis. So there are gene-wise difference, sample-wise difference, different level of difference, and the gene sample specific blocks. So if like this is called a group of genes only specifically happens in a group of samples. This is called bi-cluster analysis. It's specifically good for what? It's specifically good for kind of if we have a large cohort of cancer patients. And among those patients, we don't know what kind of, if there's a certain group of samples are more kind of, if there's a certain group of samples that are more kind of sensitive or resistant to a certain drug. But we don't know. Sometimes we don't know because actually when we deal with patient data, it's very hard because patient is with kind of when we treat patients, there's always a survival data. It's not kind of, sometimes we have a responder or non-responder, but also it depends on the tumor volume change. I can't show it here because it's, let me see if I can show it here. Let me see if I can show it somewhere here. So this is an interesting case. This is kind of a clinical trial data. It's already published, so I think I can show it here. So this is how it looks like. It's a clinical trial data. So here is the clinical phase. This is real patient data, and we treat with certain drug. And this is tumor volume change. You can see it. So some patients, and this is the x-axis is the patient kind of the treatment cycles. So you can see from this is the early cycle, cycle five, each cycle may take 4 weeks. This is a long-term treatment. And so this is cycle five to cycle 31, even it's longer, but I didn't show it here. But then what we can see is, you can see definitely there are some patients with progression disease. That means we treat the drug on it, and then the tumor volume still increase. And there are some patients that are with more like stable disease. Even there are some patients that get very good response in earlier stage, but they get good poor response in later stage. Still some patients, they get early stage response, but then they get a poor longer term response, right? Not so good early stage response, but they get a very good long-term response. But in the through the long-term methods tell you, some of the patients also revert their kind of disease progression status. So this makes the kind of identification of the kind of the response mechanism be very hard because there is no hard kind of threshold. So what we can do is the best way we can do is we want to see if there is a especially when we want to identify some mechanism related to the poor response. So what we want to do is we want to identify if a subset of the genes that show distinct expression in a subset of samples, and those samples are more likely to be with worse response. This is just our underlying question. So to see this, to get this question can be done, we develop, next time, Mr. Chang Lin Wan from my lab will introduce this related, a relevant technique he has developed to solve this this challenge. Mm-hmm. So, but I can show you one case. So I'm trying to find the figure. So, but yeah, we will show the details. Here we go. So this is from a paper of the drug resistance, you can see. So here is kind of the, what? Here is kind of the blocks, different blocks. And this here, our method identified distinct regions, those regions. And those regions are kind of more enriched by certain upregulation of such. The red regions are enriched by certain upregulated genes genes specifically upregulated. And those genes and may form definitely different blocks. And for this different block, we can see very distinct kind of drug resistance mechanisms happening in those blocks. And this suggests first that those genes can be potentially related to those drug resistance, but also secondly is that those genes are different. You see, each column is one sample, each row is one gene. Those trends are different. For example, the samples of this block and it's very different to those samples because they don't have this block there, right? So this just tell you kind of if a subset of genes and a subset of samples show distinct pattern and relevant to the kind of a certain disease outcome, they may tell certain resistant mechanism. And intuitively, so for a drug, kind of for one drug, if they form the kind of, if they get more easier to form a resistant mechanism, so that means there are maybe more possible alternative mechanisms that can lead to the drug's resistance. Okay, this may be a little bit vague, maybe a little bit complicated, but intuitively what you can think is, so the drug may target a certain function. For example, it may target a certain kind of in our cell, everything are well organized by signals. So if we want to proliferate, they may need to trigger this kind of a certain signal, kind of make the cell start to proliferate. But there are multiple kind of gatekeepers like there to kind of tell the cell, okay, you shouldn't proliferate. But then when there are some disease, especially in cancer, so they just block or kind of suppress such gatekeepers. And then what will happen is, when there are some other things that may trigger cell proliferation, so in the tumor genesis or kind of formation beginning oncogenesis in the initial generation of cancer, so the cells may start to proliferate. But when you treat the drug, the cancer with certain drugs, kind of reactive the gatekeepers, then there may be some other kind of cancer may get, kind of because cancer is proliferating and things are keeping evolving. So there are the local evolution may trigger definitely some of the emergency of more kind of mechanisms can suppress the gatekeepers. So that causes the induced kind of a resistance. And definitely, so those is a kind of, there are alternative ways of the kind of suppression and may induce to the kind of resistance. But you can see, so you for the figure I just shown, so it's kind of just with some R plot, right? So then here are some gene-wise difference, sample-wise difference, gene-sample-specific block. And another one is gene-wise correlation. So what is correlation? So I will talk this later, but it's just to tell you, okay, if gene 1 and gene 2 are highly correlated with each other, and they may have some meaning, right? So they can be relevant to a function, or they can, so there are different cases. If two genes, that we know those genes are of tightly kind of related function, if they see they are correlated, so it's not a kind of a surprise, right? It's not a surprise. But if we know those two genes are kind of definitely they shouldn't be correlated, kind of, or they normally they are not correlated. But in this, under this specific case, we saw, they are correlating with each other. Then, okay, so they can suggest some specific functions, but how to measure them? So statistically, it's with some background you may need to learn, but maybe you have already learned it, but by using programming, it's just one line of command. I may show it later, okay? So we just go for the test of difference first. So it's just a t-test. So you may, if you haven't learned t-test, I believe in the future you will learn it. It's not a big, kind of a, not a highly challenging thing for you. But basically the idea is that you have two observations and like this. And if you want to see if they are highly different, if they are different or not, you may see, you may observe, sometimes you may observe as these patterns. So you see healthy and the disease, the distribution of the data are highly different, right? This is highly different, but it looks like this, they are overlapped. They're not that different, right? Like this, they're even more different because their overlap is small. What determines their overlap? First is their kind of a mean difference. Second is their variation, kind of how kind of a random, how much randomness there are, right? Kind of can show this. But this is maybe a little bit difficult, a little bit vague, but what we can do is we can do some real world data analysis to show this example, right? So let me load into the data and load into some code. So here's, yes. Sorry, my computer is becoming a little bit slow these days. So here we have two data sets, okay. And we upload cancer data and normal data. These are about two data. So one is cancer data, one is normal data. So this cancer data and normal data are definitely, we illustrated the heat map last time. So here we can see the dimension of the cancer data is what is about 456 samples. And dimension of normal data, they are about 41 samples. So we can just pick one gene. For example, 100 gene. So we see it, how it looks like. It looks like this distribution, right? We use histogram and we see cancer. So we can definitely set two, print them together into two kind of plots. But we see something maybe not so kind of straightforward is that, so here the x-axis ranges from 0 to 1.4, here from 1 to 0.45. So we should let them have the same limb. And then we can see roughly how it looks like. Oh, here we can see. For this one, we can't tell whether they are exactly the same or different. So we can just conduct a t-test to see if they are really have show some are the same or different. We see, we conduct a t-test. Oh, they are different. But the p-value is not so significant. Here's a p-value. So if you learn statistics, p-value means kind of, you may know the p-value means the probability that happening, these things happen. If we consider, if we assume the mean of these two are different, are the same. But if we don't haven't learned this, I can just direct tell you, you can understand in this way. So t-test may tell you how different these two observations are in terms of their mean difference. And this p-value, the smaller means, more smaller means, the smaller means the more difference, okay? And this t means, the negative means the first one is lower than the second one, okay? If we find, do another gene, so we put a GID here, we put a GID here. Since we haven't introduced the for loop, so I will not do it one, kind of use for loop to do it one by one, but here we can add a GID here to see kind of how difference they are, the kind of just to pick some genes and then do the, do illustrate the kind of the difference. Oh, here we see, wow, in cancer. Oh, but this is a special case. This is a majority of the, but this is a, you see cancer, majority of them are with some values, but it's not so, this is not a good case. Okay, some, how about do it this one? Let's directly go for a known gene. So we don't do it, actually. So here we go. But here we do what? We do, we can make it be, it looks better. This is X, this is Y. So we plot X and Y and X lim equal to C. So by doing this, we can, it enable us to, see, oh, what's this kind of the minimal and the maximal of X and Y. So here is the, oh, sorry. Here we go. So we can plot the cancer and normal. And you see that from this figure, we can already say, oh, X tends to be much higher than Y, right? Because here, the mean of X is around here. The mean of Y is around here, right? If we do a t-test of X and Y, you may show, oh, they are really different. And kind of X and Y have a distinct difference. And X is much larger. And the p-value is really, really small. Which means they are with really big difference, right? This is called the differential, this just do the difference test, just one command line, t-test, right? So, and then with this result, you can directly tell your, if your advisor want to ask you, okay, what is the most different kind of among the 55,000 genes? What is the most different genes? What are the most different genes? For example, top 100. Because normally we don't do use top one. Because always we can get a huge, relatively large list of genes show difference. So we may select the top, maybe top 100, top 200, maybe top 1,000. Depends on the purpose, right? We may have some downstream analysis. I may show it in our later lectures. But here, just you can know, even you don't know t-test, some exact kind of the meanings, the underlying mathematics, but using R, just one command line, if used correctly, it can give you meaningful results, okay? So, but similarly, it's like the difference of two gene expression. If you are work on, for example, economic data, you want to tell, okay, what is their kind of, whether the income or whatever other features in the kind of into two group or two geography region or spatial region, they show, or two community, two cities, they are different, still use the same test, right? So then with this, you can do some rigorous statistical analysis, right? And then another thing I want to show you is about the sample-wise difference. When we measure sample-wise difference, it's not so easy, we cannot use correlation. Sorry, we cannot use t-test. For example, if here we have two genes, we can test them. But for cancer, just goes for sample, we just still do this. So sample one and sample two. So even we pick two normal samples, normal and cancer samples. You see, they're not so different. We change it to different ones. They're not so very different. This one is different, but they are not so different. What's the reason? What's the reason? So because we are measuring different things for each patient, you can consider those as the weight, the height, they're of different characteristics. So if we merge them together and compare them, what's their span? So what's their so like I mentioned, so if they have a large variance, it's cannot be well compared. So this is how they look like. They look like so similar, very similar to each other. So this is not kind of a very good idea to estimate their difference. But there's another way. It's called a hierarchical clustering. I think for a high school student, I think it's a time, especially for you who you attend this project. I believe you are very good. So you can definitely do some kind of advanced reading. So here I may want to provide one website I found is good for to introduce hierarchical clustering. So what is hierarchical clustering here? So I put it in the chat as well. So feel free to read it. So chat. Oh, here we go. Yeah, here is this programming. Yeah. So here is you have the data. So for each of the, so for example, we have samples, right? For each of the sample, we can compute their distance. So what is the distance? So we can compute their, one way to compute distance, straightforward, is using Euclidean distance. You just have the, so how to compute Euclidean distance? So here is a P and the Q, if there are 2 points, you just compute their difference, right? For R, this fairly easy actually. So for example, if we just pick the first 1,000 genes of it, right? So we just a very straightforward command is use dist function. It can directly directly give you the distance of those samples, their distance. Compute their distance. But another way to compute it, for example, if you want to compute one and compute two, you really want to compute one and compute two. It's not hard. Because what is the way R compute things, you minus, you just get their old distance, kind of old difference. You take a square and you sum it. Sum the square, and then you take a square root. This is how the Euclidean distance is computed, right? Because you have a 1,000 vector, 1,000 another. You see, a vector of the length 1,000, another vector of length 1,000. You just take the difference and use a square of them. And the sum of the square and take the square root of the sum of the square is Euclidean distance, right? I believe this is in you have learned this, right? How to compute distance, right? And here we can simply use the dist. And then we can simply use the hclast to do the dist of them. And then what this looks like, not like a result, right? With this, but you plot it. When you plot it, you can show, it shows distinct how the samples are close or not close to each other. Kind of you can conduct their, kind of whether they are close. But how the hierarchical clustering is meaning is that you have the distance of each sample pair, right? A, B, C, D, E, A, B, C, D, E, F, right? You have their pairwise distance. And here, if we put them use this to show their kind of to illustrate a 2D visualization. Everyone likes 2D visualization. It's better to kind of to illustrate the idea and the data, right? So we start from the two closest samples and then merge them into one class. Then we compute, then kind of we merge them into one and use their center as their place and recompute this the distance of the among these five. We pick the next two closest samples and merge them together. And then we do further, right? And get them totally merged. This should be a typo. This should be looks like here and one. So this figure is not correct. But the idea you may get, okay, we merge this. After first merge these two to get this, further merge these two to get this. And then we found these two are the closest. We merge this two, this three, this two, and actually form a cluster of three. And then we further merge these two and form a cluster of four and then merge them together. Then you can say AB are, EF are first merged, then AB, and then EFD, EFDC. So this is EF, AB, EFD, EFDC, and EFDC with AB, right? Here, this dendrogram tells you the order how the cluster was conducted. So here, exactly the orders. The good thing is that, so why we need an edge class? Because it's in hierarchical way, so each time, if we just add, so sorry, I cannot make a note on it, but we just use this as a kind of a cut, kind of a line to cut it, right? Is that okay? I think it's okay. So for example, if we cut it here, that means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 class. Right. If we cut it here, we put it into two clusters. We cut it here, we put it into three clusters, 1, 2, 3. But this, when we observe this data, what it tells that these two are highly different to the others. The other looks kind of more evenly distributed. These two can be outliers. We can exclude these two from our analysis because these two are so different. And then for the rest, we can do our normal downstream analysis. But what it tells is, if we do the kind of to cut it at different regions, we may see how many branches on top of the cut and can give us the number of clusters. So for example, we can use cut tree here. It's called cut tree. And with k equal to, for example, 5, it may give us 5 clusters. 1 equal to 5, 1 equal to 4, 2 outliers. The rest get into 3 clusters, 1, 2, 3. But if this, you think this is not so distinct, we put it into 6, then it kind of with 1, 2, 2 outliers, 1, 2, 3, 4, just 4 clusters. Got it? So this is how it works. So it's called hierarchical clustering. So now you already can, already when your professor asks you, oh, if you can give me kind of, if I have multiple samples, you can tell me how similar they are. So there is a way called hierarchical clustering to do the analysis. So the last thing I want to introduce today is a little bit about correlation, but actually it's more for the correlation. When I prepare it, it's more for correlation network analysis. So correlation, if I haven't learned it, so it's just a measure to measure how similar two values are. And still, using simple command line. So kind of it's called curl. So for example, if we do there, but correlation, you have to compute the correlation of two kind of vectors of the same length. Okay. So for example, we compute this. These are two data. So two genes. So these two genes, you see their name, CCNE1, CCNE2. These are two cycling genes. I think they should be highly similar. Oh, they're not. These two are good. So you see here? So how to say they are, whether they are similar or not? You plot them. Plot X and Y. These are the two genes. Each dot is one sample. So that means the sample with hierarchy of the first gene and expression of the first gene, they should have higher expression of the second gene. The expression of CCNB1 and CCNB2, they are highly dependent. Those two genes, from the name, you can say they are quite similar, right? So there are two genes involved in the one cell cycle phase. And so if you have definitely, if cells need one, cell may also need the other to complete the analysis, kind of the process. These two are maybe outliers. They just, when they get high expression of the first of the CCNB1, they didn't get high expression of CCNB2. They can be certain story, definitely. But this just to tell you how kind of similar they are, or kind of how, not similar, but how consistent or kind of their dependence. I mean, if they form a certain kind of co-up or co-down trend in the samples. So it's just it takes value from one, -1 to one. -1 means most negatively correlated, more one means most positively correlated. So the higher value means more positive dependency, lower value means more negative dependency. Zero means no correlation, okay? So here basically the idea is this, okay? So it's got a correlation, but then there are some algorithms so developed. So we are definitely interested in kind of genes show distinct correlation. But then how about this? So if we have the last thing I want to show is if we have this group, I just randomly give a group of genes, okay? Not random, but just give a group of genes as an example, okay? Should be okay. For example, this one, out of bound. Still. Yes, here we go. This is good. So we see, let's test their correlation. Oh, this one is not good. This one is not good, okay? So you see here, most of the genes are with high correlation, but not this one, right? So we change it to another one. So, okay. How about 3A2? This should be okay. No. Another one. This should be okay. TX, yeah. You see, here, they are highly correlated, this group of genes. So they are all very highly correlated with each other. So you can see the correlation of 7, 8, 8, 8, you just pick 1.86 as what? So we just plot, we just put two genes, one is this one, and one is, this one, okay. So we just put two genes. You can see their correlation is 0.87. You can see how it looks like. Definitely we can tell they are trend. The higher the first one, the lower the higher the second one, right? So if you get a correlation of this one, this means they are all highly connected with each other. They call it a gene module. We call this as a gene co-expression module. So the gene co-expression module means what? Means a group of genes, between each of them, they're highly correlated, right? So this, but definitely from the name, you can say, oh, they are definitely looks like very similar, right? But in the data analysis, there are some computational ways to predict and derive such correlated gene, kind of this highly correlated gene modules. It's called gene co-expression module, and this may directly tell you some like functions. And here is the analysis. It's called gene co-expression analysis. From gene expression to get a target list of genes and do the gene co-expression analysis, and then to predict and construct the network and make them form a kind of a gene co-expression network. A gene co-expression network is formed by genes that are highly correlated in terms of their gene expression. We can definitely utilize the idea of the chiral clustering and replace the distance with the correlation and to do the correlation network inference. But there are also multiple other methods. We can show it in our later lectures. But here, just to show, oh, you see how many command lines we did use? Just this. loading data, and some visualization, some key commands, including t-test, hierarchy cluster, and cache, and also correlation, COR, and also identify, definitely there are some other ways to identify a group of highly correlated genes. Just you can implement with hierarchy clustering. That's it. We can do some research, right?
Dr. Zhang, thank you so much for your time and for showing how powerful these programs are.
Mm-hmm.
Students, would you all go to your reaction button and say thank you or throw thank you into the chat there?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you so much for your time. And students, there's a 1 o'clock mm-hmm. lecture.
I believe, yeah.
On a different Zoom link. So you can go the electronic equivalent of run down the hall. To the next lecture. Dr. Zhang, again, thank you so much.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for your time. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.